Throughout our history, we Americans have held the West close to our hearts. But today the region is under siege. The West's population is growing at 3 times the national average. The result has been a dramatic loss of agricultural lands. In Colorado, the 5th fastest growing state in the nation, 1,700 acres are taken out of production every week. Vast open spaces are giving way to subdivisions to house the many newcomers. Ranchers are fighting to keep possession of their land. Native Americans are struggling to maintain their culture amid this influx of newcomers. But the newcomers to the West will not be turned away. The competition for the landscape of the American West is fierce. And as in all competitions, there are winners and losers. This is the story of 3 Westerners caught in this competition. Lee and Billy Taylor have recently moved to the West to start a family, while Diane Holly fights to hold on to her family's ranch amidst the new development surrounding her. And on the Navajo Reservation, Leo Mannheimer struggles to protect a sacred tribal site against an influx of tourists. These 3 stories form the narrative of America's changing West. Arnie and Diane Holly operate the Overlook Ranch in northern Colorado, just outside the small community of Steamboat Springs. Diane took over the 2,000-acre spread when her father retired 10 years ago. But in the economy of today's West, where land is rapidly being developed and vast agricultural enterprises make it difficult for family-run ranches to compete, many ranchers have to take a second job to make ends meet. Arnie works full-time at the local power plant, and Diane works at a nearby school. They work the ranch in the evenings and on weekends, and were making do until Diane's father died in a car accident, coming to visit her on Christmas Eve.
Well, life was really easy for a while, and then it got really complicated. There was a freak ice storm, bare pavement, and they came around a corner, it was pure ice, rolled the pickup, and he didn't survive. You have to deal with the shock of your father being dead and that whole grieving process, and then you suddenly realize that it's going to change your life in other major ways. We started looking into things and found out we were really in trouble, had to fill out a bunch of forms, have to get evaluations, that realistically, we could lose the ranch.
When a ranch is handed down from one generation to the next, the IRS taxes it, and in Diane's case, the estate taxes could be as much as 50% of the ranch's appraised value. If the Hollies can't pay the tax, they will lose the ranch.
Then we found out we only have 9 months from the date of death to file. If it's several thousand dollars, you can borrow money. But if it's hundreds of thousands, there's no way an income off this ranch could ever even pay the interest, let alone the principal on that.
Diane's great-grandfather homesteaded the Overlook Ranch over 100 years ago, when the area was populated with ranchers and miners. But in the landscape of the New West, nearby Steamboat Springs, like Telluride, is changing significantly. Both towns are growing rapidly, and land values and property taxes have risen accordingly.
It's my location, it's being by steamboat, and having the land values skyrocket. That is the major factor. That's why we're in trouble.
Today, Steamboat Springs is a resort community, but it wasn't always like this. The area was named by 3 fur trappers in 1865. Who thought the chugging noise they heard coming from a hot spring sounded like a steamboat. The settlement remained a mining and ranching community for over 100 years. Then in the 1970s, the local ski hill was developed into a resort, and the character of the town changed. Now million-dollar homes dot the hillsides and expensive boutiques line the main street.
What got us was these escalating land values. It has nothing to do with what we're doing with the land. We've pretty much farmed it and ranched it since the 1800s the same way. But because of valuations around me, we found out that we're worth millions on paper.
But millions on paper doesn't translate into a significant yearly income.
At the best, I would think this ranch would bring in $30,000 a year. If we owe a tax liability of $500,000, this income off this ranch can't even pay the interest on that, let alone the principal. Then we found out we only have 9 months from the date of death to file. You're in total shock. This can't be happening to us.
With only months left, Diane feels it is important that the boys know the history of the ranch.
That's the house you live in. Yeah, can you pick out your bedroom? The back sign, yeah. It was moved up with 4 bobsleds and 26 head of horses. They did it in the winter. Your granddad. No, it'd be your grandpa. My dad was born in that house.
The Overlook Ranch was homesteaded by Diane's great-grandfather, James Hitchens, in 1886. He handed it down to his son, Albert, who in turn handed it down to Diane's father, Harold.
It's going to be really hard to give all that up because it is a generational thing. It repeats itself, and it's so comforting and so neat to see. See it happening over and over. Same scene, different family.
Diane grew up on the ranch and attended school in Steamboat. She met Arnie after finishing college, and they married in 1980. Now their children are being raised on the ranch.
This is your grandfather, Errol, my dad. He's 4 years old there. He was a little towhead. You know what a towhead is? A towhead. A towhead is a little blondie. They used to call him towhead. Look at, he doesn't wear any shoes. In those little overalls, looks like he's about ready to outgrow them, doesn't it? Getting a little bit high water there. Tomorrow the tax attorney is coming at 9:00 in the morning. We've waited for a month and a half for this. And we could hardly wait for it to come, and now that it comes, it's kind of foreboding. I don't know what she'll tell us. That's the scary part, is I'm hoping she'll say it's fixable. But the reality part of me says, you are gonna owe this many hundreds of thousands of dollars. Let's find a way to raise that money. And that's what I don't wanna face. Because finding a way to raise the money is selling. Or the ranch.
The situation that the Hollies find themselves in is not uncommon. The change in land values and agricultural economics taking place throughout the West is making it increasingly difficult to run family ranches.
Now, you don't have to have a PhD in agricultural science to understand that you can raise cattle that are going to be fatter and you can raise them cheaper back in Iowa on feedlots. That's not really what we're talking about. We're not talking about economics, we're talking about lifestyles. And we're talking about the soul of a region and the heart of a nation. If you lose the rancher economy, if you lose the real working cowboy, not Hollywood cowboys, not singing cowboys, not the sort of cultural motifs we have, which are important and vital to our nation, but if we lose that which they celebrate, the actual people working the land, then we're going to lose the essence of the West.
Diane has been waiting for this day for months. The tax attorney has reviewed the family situation and should be able to give them some answers.
I don't know what's going to happen, and that's the scariest part, is not to have control. All your life you have control over your land, your choices, your family, and suddenly everything's taken out of your hands. And you sit down at the table and I don't know what to expect.
All right, well, if the estate is $1.5 million, after you take the unified credit off, you're looking at around $363,000 in taxes.
Okay, which we owe $363,000.
Now that's saying...
That is just unfathomable to us. I think the two boys were watching from the background, because for 3 days I kept saying, okay, this is when the lawyer's coming.
Okay, so say this happens, then how much time do you have to come up with this kind of money?
9 months from the date of death.
Oh, so that means September, well, that wouldn't happen.
I think the two boys sense that it's a very serious situation. Okay, this is what we found out. I know you're a little nervous. We found out that it isn't as bad as it was, but we'll probably owe maybe $400,000 in taxes, which we can't pay off of, right? We can't pay anything off. But it all depends on figures, and we have to wait till they decide what we're worth. We still don't know what we're worth, so we'll see. So we kind of know a little more, but we still don't know what we want to do. One thing we do know, we're all going to live together. We're not going to sell you.
Why not?
Right? We will live together no matter where it is, and that's what counts. Even though we met with the lawyer, it's only the beginning. It seems so incredibly complicated. I wish it were the end. It's going to get even more complicated and worse. Now we have to wait on the valuator.
To know precisely what the taxes will be, the ranch has to be appraised. But the appraiser cannot come right away, and the wait is difficult for Diane and Arnie.
I'm emotionally attached to the ranch. I want to save it at all costs.
We can separate off a piece of the ranch and still come out pretty darn good shape.
When Arnie started pressing me and saying, Diane, you got to look at this realistically, we might have to sell out, I was so angry with him.
I've pushed it along, and I think there's a lot better thing to do than what my wife wants to do.
If we can't agree on something, then it gets tense. And it's kind of like, well, it's your ranch, you've lived here all your life, I guess you get to decide. And that's not fair either.
As they pass time waiting for the appraisal, Diane tries to bring the family together to do the things they've done every summer.
It's a really good place to raise kids, because you're totally involved in them 24 hours a day. And that I believe in the lifestyle, and that we're more of a family together. But I have taken extra time to say, guys, I'll try everything I can to hang on to the ranch.
What'd you have to rewind it?
There's days when you have hope. Then you have days where it looks good and you're thinking, well, maybe the valuation won't come in as high. But then you look at other listings, and every day it seems like the land is going up.
As the date of the appraisal nears, Diane and Arnie find it difficult to discuss the future of their ranch.
I prefer to put my head in the sand and deal with it later and see where we're at. Arnie is more practical.
I've called a planner and talked to, not to a developer, but to the planner, and he has some developers in mind that are very interested in this area.
He's been looking at places in case we have to sell. He's been talking to developers in case we have to develop a piece of it, which totally depresses me.
If we do that, that would be the greatest amount of money we could probably get out of it, releasing the smallest amount of property.
And I don't want to have to go with him just because I think he's the head of the household and I have to, and that it'll smooth things over so I won't have to address it later. I don't know how to put this. What it really boils down to is I'm passive and Arnie's aggressive. That's kind of personal, but that really does enter into it, personalities, and not get into a power struggle.
Just before the appraisal comes, Diane tries to explain to the boys why she feels so strongly about keeping the ranch.
Remember when Grandpa, a long time ago, said he was going to sell the ranch? He was thinking about it. A hunter had offered him a lot of money, and he came and asked us. He said, you know, I can sell out, and I'll give you part of the money. And that's when I was really shocked, and I said, oh, I thought you were going to hand it down to me, and then I'd hand it down to the grandkids. And he got real teary-eyed. He basically held on to this ranch for you, too, and Sophie. That was a big sacrifice for him because he could have had a lot of money and gone and traveled in his retirement. He basically left this ranch to you, to me in between, but I promised him that I'd give it to you.
Diane has just heard from the appraiser. He will hand deliver the report tomorrow.
We still don't know what we owe. We have a special tax attorney. We have the valuation coming in, and we have no idea. And that's the hard part. It's up and down from day to day. One day you have hope, one day it seems hopeless.
Good morning.
Good morning, Larry. I guess I'm ready.
Got the news, whether it be good or bad.
I know. I've been waiting all this time for this, and now I'm kind of scared to do it, but let's go do it. Have a seat.
Thank you. There's your copy of the report. The current appraisal represents what's happening in the market now. And we've seen a tremendous growth in recreational buyers come to this area. The whole face of this county is changing.
So is my tax liability this? The $1,286,000?
Option may be to borrow the money.
That's no option.
If that's the case, you're right back to square one.
The ranch has been appraised at $2,400,000. Because her father gave her half of the ranch before he died, Diane owes taxes on half of the ranch's appraisal. Diane calls Arnie at work with the news.
He came out with, it's $1,286,300 that we owe on. I mean, that's the figure for the 50%. So how do you feel about that? You want to stay? I want to stay. Mm-hmm. Well, we'll discuss that when you get home. Okay. After we got the appraisal, Arnie and I had to start discussing some realities. And we had to find times when both of us wanted to talk. That was really hard. Now that we've gone through this whole process and I've had a lot of time to cry and think, I've learned to detach emotionally and say, okay, I got all these great memories. I don't need the physical sight. I'm learning to just step back and saying this isn't the end of my life. Well, we've decided probably the easiest, fastest way to generate money to pay taxes is to put in a housing development or some kind of housing tract. It's not the way I wanted to go. I guess I'm compromising because at least we don't have to move. Arnie has to think financial, what's best for the family. I am torn because I think of the emotional, preserving the past, preserving it for the future generation, keeping the land. I mean, it's been the same way since the 1800s. It's gone through the World Wars, it's gone through the Depression, it's gone through all this. I just have this real need to keep it going. I mean, you always diversify as a farmer or rancher, but putting a housing development to me is just more than diversifying. It's a done deal. It's so final. It's so big impact. But I guess we all have to move on. And that's tough. And it's not because I don't like people. And it's not because I don't mind a neighbor with a house next to me. It's the idea that that land was handed down to me. And I feel this sense that I have to protect it and keep it. And I'm not protecting it and keeping it. I'm selling out.
While stories similar to that of the Hollies are unfolding in increasing numbers across the West today, these stories are not new. New residents have always displaced those who came before.
The story of the West has always been this story of change, of one people displacing another. In that sense, we can see that the changes that are going on today are not new, but the changes that are going on today are different. Because now there are so many people in the West, and the resources of the land are stretched so thin that there may indeed not be a place for traditional ways.
But others value the newcomers for the energy and vitality they bring to the West.
I don't think we have to worry about saving these old West icons. I think they will survive. They'll survive maybe in different places or in smaller numbers, but they'll survive as long as it makes economic sense. If we didn't have change and growth in the West would atrophy and die.
Lee and Billy Taylor are telecommuters living in Telluride, Colorado. They recently relocated from the Silicon Valley in California, where Lee managed a small computer company and Billy had a thriving physical therapy practice. They now work from their home using modern communication technology. Like many newcomers to the West, they moved to the region to start a family far from the problems of big city life.
We were in the modern rat race. To me, that was the thing that finally pushed over the edge and said, what the heck? Let's go to Colorado and build a house.
We felt this was crazy.
You did?
At least for now and then. Yeah, this was almost an act, it was a leap of faith to do this.
When Lee and Billy Taylor moved to Telluride, they had no jobs, no house, and no family waiting for them. What they did have was a dream for a new life.
When we chose to move here, it was the business of working here was almost not on our minds. The living here was on our mind. The quality of life, the quality of town, the quality of opportunity for a child we hoped to raise and still do.
One of the draws is just the raw physical beauty of the place. The thing is that life here is less abstract. It's much more real. You are on a first name basis with almost everybody in town. And it's just a totally different feel and experience. I mean, it's fun to go downtown, down to Telluride, when you've been out of town for 2 or 3 weeks, because you get greeted.
This friendly small town feel is far different from what Lee and Billy left behind.
At the time when we decided to buy land and move here, we were classic dinks in the Silicon Valley. Between my regular job and Billy's multiple jobs, we were ships passing in the night, pretty much.
It was my choice, I think. We chose to work, but so did everybody around us. It wasn't like we were drawn in, but we were about the only neighbors who knew any of our neighbors in that neighborhood and whoever thought to introduce ourselves to each other. So. When we came here and had this idea that there's a community here, and it's a small town.
Communities like Telluride are becoming more attractive because of the scenic beauty and tight-knit community atmosphere that they offer.
When we decided to move to the West, we didn't feel like we were part of a migration. We felt more like we made a personal decision. We've noticed, however, the migration since we came here. It's become really apparent to us.
Lee and Billy are part of the latest wave of Western immigrants. Immigrants of a kind that the United States government, who in the 1800s advocated a policy of Western expansion, could not have predicted. Miners looking for a better life settled the Telluride area in the 1870s. But a better life did not necessarily mean an easy one. People say the town's name evolved from the farewell given to prospective settlers who were told, "To hell you ride," as they packed their bags and headed to the Colorado Highlands. And today, moving to Telluride can still be a struggle.
To just jump into this no man's land on the idea that we could pull this off, that we can do this, without necessarily a string of clients or anybody in the area who knew us at all, to make our way in this new place on the idea that it was what we wanted to do was almost arrogant. But it's happening.
Trusting.
It's trusting.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're pretty sure of ourselves.
Lee and Billy left job security in a bustling city for employment uncertainty in a town with only 1,500 year-round residents.
Well, having chosen a small town to live in for a variety of personal reasons, having to do with values and family, we also find ourselves in a place where, or at least I do, where the population base is not adequate to support a caseload for me in the specialized kind of work I do.
Lee and Billy did what many newcomers to the West end up doing. They created their own jobs.
I did not come here thinking I was going to have a lot of physical therapy clinic work. I came here thinking we were going to have a life in the community and start a family sometime soon and be where we wanted to be and then make work for us to support this choice.
And we're really lucky to be able to do it. In my case, the information age revolution came along just in time for me to be able to do this.
The information age has made it easier for newcomers to the West to work in remote areas. Telecommuters can now use faxes and computer modems to stay connected. But the decision to move to a remote area of the West is not easy.
The decision to become a telecommuter for most people requires a huge leap of faith because you're leaving an area you know for one you don't know, and because you're leaving a lifestyle which you know and which is convenient and which you have grown up with for one that's more like a dream or a fantasy.
The great thing is, if I want to take a hike, I walk out the door and I call the dogs and I'm there. 5 minutes from now, I'm on a Jeep trail on the way past an abandoned mine and there's nobody around. And I'm watching the eagles fly over the cliffs and the whole nine yards.
While Telluride has beauty and small-town atmosphere to spare, what it doesn't offer is a wide range of employment opportunities.
There have been a few crises of faith because of the magnitude of the effort to sustain an income in a place that's so remote. I mean, I can say, I have said a few times to Lee, are you sure we shouldn't be in something like Green Bay, Wisconsin, or somewhere where there's people?
In California, Lee worked as a manager in the computer industry, but when he and Billy moved to Telluride, he found he could no longer rely on working for a large company.
I think the nature of the work that I do is made possible by the changes and improvements in telecommunication that we've been through in the past, you know, 5-10 years.
Lee started his own business on the internet.
The startup that I'm working on now is called Tix2Go, and we are a web-based ticketing, registration, reservation system.
Lee's company is like many other companies that sell tickets for events. What is different about Lee's company is that it has no offices and no sales staff.
You know, the term virtual gets thrown around a lot, but if you look at the way we do operations, you'd see that we really are. We exist on the net more than we do physically anywhere else. The beauty of our setup on the web is that we can literally service any client anywhere. We can bring them customers from anywhere.
Right.
We do the work from anywhere.
Both Lee and Billy want to give back to their community. So when the town of Telluride got together to put on their annual jazz festival, Lee saw a chance to become involved.
I suppose one could make the case that Tixtego is already an international concern, but you know, the local touch is still very important. We want to be able to bring, say in my case here in Telluride, I want to help the local economy, I want to help the local businesses, many of whom are my friends. Being able to ticket for provide services to the jazz festival was a first step for us in being able to make a significant contribution to the arts and events and activities community in this region.
As Lee worked to build his company on the internet, Billy was forced to find her own employment solutions. Before moving to Telluride, Billy was a physical therapist with a thriving practice.
I really do love it, especially because I treat children.
Billy was determined to make a go of it, even though the small population of the Telluride area meant that clients might be few and far between.
So there are two ways that I've managed to address that issue. Videotape consults are becoming a somewhat regular part of my work.
Parents who need specialized help for their children send videotapes to Billy in Telluride. She then reviews the tapes and consults with the families over the phone.
Andy, who is now 15, was my patient when he was 8 months. And at that point, I'd been practicing a few years. And Andy was an infant with a stroke. Well, no matter where I've lived, Andy and I have been connected. Now we have videotape. And so if it happens that for some reason it's going to be more than a couple of years before I see Andy again, we can communicate by videotape and certainly on the telephone. I operate for Andy as something of a shaper of the course of his rehabilitation. I'm not executing it. I simply design it and request specifications on things like his bracing and his management. The fact that I'm living in Telluride, Colorado really has no bearing at all on the fact that Andy and I are still connected and working together on his rehabilitation and his physical skills.
Hi, Andy.
Hello.
How you doing?
Good.
How you been doing?
Good.
Good. Well, listen, I'm looking at your video,
uh-huh.
And I'm liking what I'm seeing. I see some nice knee motion there. I see a much smoother gait pattern.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's really cool. And, you know, you're definitely filling out. There's no doubt about it. You're turning into a teenager. You know, the first time I saw you, you were 9 months old. Listen, I've actually been wondering about your brace.
When a child gets better, and I feel I had anything to do with it, I just feel great.
Modern technology has opened the door for people like Lee and Billy to create their own livelihoods while living in beautiful and isolated Western towns. But to some degree, Lee and Billy have been lucky. Finding a way to make a living in the place you love is still a dream for most people. But their luck hasn't come without effort.
Well, I don't think what we've done here is heroic or epic. It's more a matter of determination. We came here because we wanted to be here. And so we do what we do so that we can stay. And you know, if you can do that, then, and I don't know if that's that much different from pioneers of you know, who broke the West. You know, there's real similarities there. You gotta want it. That's what it comes down to, I think.
Lee and Billy want to live in Telluride enough to endure the criticism that many newcomers to the West face. New residents are often criticized for changing the region's traditional social and economic fabric, but Lee and Billy see it differently.
I think there are strong and weak elements of the migration to the West. I think the weak elements are those that take more from the area than they give. So I would have to address anyone's objections to my being here by expressing my hope that I can contribute more than I take from the area.
It can also, I can't say that Telluride would be better off if it was had 400 people in it and it was still a dead mining town. With all due respect, I'd suggest that anyone with a particular perspective that feels that the West should never change simply has a short-term view of history, because of course the West has changed. We've changed the West ever since we set eyes on it. But there's real costs and there's real pain. A rancher that Some of these ranches around here have been in their families for three or four generations, which to us is a long time. And it has to be painful to think about being forced to subdivide or to close down the ranch as a ranch out of economic necessity. And I can't even fathom what that must be like.
What families like the Taylors represent is the future of the West cultural and physical landscape. The inevitable impact of families like them is changing the traditional West.
Well, there's conflict in the West around the change that's occurring, because whenever you have change, you have winners and losers. But I just don't think a no-growth, no-change scenario for the West would work unless we want to fence it off and make it a museum. I would rather see a dynamic, growing, changing West, which has room for the past, but a vision of the future, which is new and different and even uncertain. You know, many years ago, Wallace Stegner, the Pulitzer Prize-winning author, said, the West is the native land of hope. It was then, and it is now. And it is because it's so amenable to change and it's so hospitable to people who want to lead a new kind of life.
What we've seen, certainly in the last quarter of a century in the West, is a massive in-migration, especially from the urban centers of the Northeast and more recently from California. People are fleeing from urban congestion. They're fleeing from crime. They're seeking a better lifestyle for themselves and especially for their children. They think they can find it in the West. Well, that's always why people have come to the West, in search of something better. That's what the West always offered to America: opportunity, chance, a place to raise your kids where they can have perhaps a chance for a good, clean, healthy life and success that you wouldn't have elsewhere. But as more and more people come to the West, because of the nature of our landscape and our resources, of course, they kill the very thing that they love.
Leo Mannheimer is a former Navajo tribal leader. He lives at the foot of Navajo Mountain in Utah, just north of the Arizona state line. Navajo Mountain lies 40 miles from the nearest paved road. It is considered one of the sacred areas of the Navajo reservation.
Navajos first gave the Park Service permission to bring people close enough to Rainbow Bridge to enjoy its beauty, the government made promises. Today, the Navajos say those promises surrounding this national...
But when Leo saw news reports on television about a conflict between tourists and Native Americans at Rainbow Bridge National Monument, he knew that things had changed.
We have allowed outside interests to come in and to desecrate.
Rainbow Bridge is a natural rock formation that sits at the base of Navajo Mountain, not far from Leo's home. It is considered sacred, and spiritual leaders from Navajo Mountain have prayed at Rainbow Bridge for generations.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. This is your 8 o'clock half-day trip to the Rainbow Bridge.
But Rainbow Bridge lies just outside of the reservation boundary, on U.S. government land on the shore of Lake Powell. Recently, it has become very popular with tourists. Thousands come on boats each day to see what many call one of the natural wonders of the world. But the influx of tourists has made it increasingly difficult for the elders from Navajo Mountain to pray at Rainbow Bridge.
You can see some of the frustrations of the elders. And that is why I couldn't help but become involved in creating a dialogue between the community and the National Park Service.
Joe Alston is the superintendent of the Glen Canyon National Recreation Area, where Rainbow Bridge is located.
The main concerns that were expressed to us by the Native American community were basically: one, they wanted to assure themselves that they were able to, in fact, use the area for their religious beliefs. That was primary.
My feelings as far as Rainbow Bridge are pretty strong. If I can make a comparison between the situation at Rainbow Bridge and one of your churches, it would be like me peeking through your church window with a camera and shooting photos of you during one of your prayer services.
But for Superintendent Alston, it is a complicated problem.
The balancing act between Native American beliefs and the visiting public, the thousands of people that come to visit Rainbow Bridge, is really our fundamental management challenge at the monument. It's the conflict of two basic rights, the right of access to public lands and the other constitutional right of the Native American people to exercise their religious freedoms.
For Leo, however, the issue is personal.
Generations of Navajo medicine people have visited Rainbow Bridge. They have made a lot of offerings, a lot of prayers, and I hate to see all of that walked on and trampled. And that is why I feel like Rainbow Bridge should be not only protected, but also visited with a lot of respect. I'm involved in these issues because, you know, I would like to one day see my kids and even their kids at least have a good sense of what Rainbow Bridge is all about.
Leo's two youngest children attend school near their home on the Navajo reservation. Leo was not as fortunate when he was their age. He was sent off the reservation to a boarding school in Albuquerque, New Mexico, far away from the traditions and learning of his people.
I remember the first day in junior high in Albuquerque, being the lone Native American in that classroom of about 32, 33 kids. Not having been beyond the Navajo, the boundaries of the Navajo reservation, it was really something that was, in a sense, shocking, culture-wise.
Leo joined the track team and did his best to fit in, but he still missed life on the reservation.
One of the things that I missed the most was just being out on the canyon lands and being out and about wherever I wanted to be.
Leo also missed out on the traditional learning and ceremonies of his people.
When I was younger, I really didn't have a teacher teach me the different facets of the Navajo religion and culture.
Even though Leo did manage to adapt to his new life, he felt something was missing and soon found himself attracted to a Navajo girl in the grade below him. Her name was Sarah.
And I think one of the things that has drawn us closer during the time we were in Albuquerque was missing a lot of things about what goes on at home. And then I guess we started to hang around together a lot.
After finishing school, Sarah became Leo's wife.
One of the best things that really ever happened to me during my years in Albuquerque was meeting my wife.
Together they moved back to Navajo Mountain, where Sarah's family lived.
I don't think there's a piece of land anywhere in my mind that could actually compare to what we have here at Navajo Mountain. It's nothing but beauty.
It was there that Leo realized his life was going to change.
For the Navajos, it's customary that the husband relocates to the wife's into the wife's family. I knew that being a part of my wife's family meant helping in a lot of the ceremonies, and so I really looked forward to it because it was a way of life that I have never experienced.
Later in life, Leo was able to gain the traditional knowledge he missed out on as a child. But he and others worry that not all Native American children will be as fortunate.
I think the loss of identity can be a very paralyzing thing. I think without some idea of their roots, without some idea of the world that their parents lived in and their grandparents and ancestors for untold generations, they don't have a security, a sense of security. They don't know who they are. They don't know how to express themselves in their in their real nature and in their real identity. They're growing up facing a world in which they do not know who they are, and of course other people don't know who they are.
When I was young, I never attended traditional ceremonies or even had an idea of what traditional ceremonies or culture was. The first real contact that I had with traditional ceremonies was when I got married into my wife's family.
Joining Sarah's family at Navajo Mountain meant learning a new way of life.
Some of the things that they did were new, very new to me. And I began to take part in a lot of these things. And I actually began to learn. It was to the point where I really appreciated the way things were done traditionally.
Sarah's grandfather, Buck, has been a Navajo medicine man for over 50 years. When Leo met Buck, he seized the opportunity to learn a traditional Navajo lifestyle.
When I was a young boy, I lost my father.
After that, it pretty much was hard on me.
And now, Buck has actually become a good father figure for me.
The process of becoming a medicine man is long and difficult. It took Buck years of training to learn the hundreds of prayers and ceremonies that he now performs.
I have a great deal of respect for him, just because of what he does, what he knows, and what it took to become who he is.
But none of Buck's knowledge is written down. Instead, it is passed down orally from one generation to the next.
He doesn't have an apprentice. Nobody's learning from him to carry on what he knows. And that's really one of the saddest things that is true throughout the whole Navajo Nation. I'm trying to learn these things because I think I will have a good sense of who I am, who I truly am. And then hopefully, if I'm able to pass that on to my kids will actually have a good sense of who they are.
Leo's oldest son, Bobby, is a local basketball star. He's preparing to leave for college on an athletic scholarship. Like any parent, Leo is proud of his son, but also a little worried. He wants Bobby to do well and adjust to school off the reservation, but he also wants Bobby to maintain his traditions. To help ensure that, Leo has asked Buck to perform a protection way ceremony for Bobby.
The purpose behind that is asking the gods to always look after him and protect him in all his travels.
Before I go off to school, I always get ceremonies done for me by my grandpa, my great-grandpa, actually. And when those ceremonies are done, they're for protection, to guide you certain directions, make you do the right things, make you make the right decisions. I want to go off the reservation and get my education, and I know some's helping me or protecting me.
One of the biggest keys surrounding how much we're able to maintain as a people probably has to do with language.
Leo's youngest child, Ryan, speaks and understands some Navajo, but he's not fluent. Leo wants to change that.
Grandpa talks about how he grew up. When he was your age, he used to running around without shoes. You know, he would go herd sheep even without any shoes. And so it was a very different world. They didn't have the shoes you have, like Air Jordans. There was nothing like that. He always stresses that it's very important to learn some of your language, learn a lot of a lot about who you are as a Navajo. As
I think it's important for an Indian child to speak the language of his community. If he's a Navajo, it's valuable that he should know the language. The language is valuable to him. There are things that you can express in Navajo, traditional things, things of that spiritual world that cannot be expressed in any other language.
As Leo turned his attention to his children at Navajo Mountain, his efforts at Rainbow Bridge produced a breakthrough.
Some of those conflicts are probably never completely resolvable, but they may be able to be compromised, and it may be able to, we may be able to meet to reach accommodation. We've done a number of things at Rainbow Bridge now that I think have shown good faith in trying to recognize that Rainbow Bridge is not just a grand scenic attraction, but a very important religious site to Native Americans.
The compromise allows tourists to continue visiting Rainbow Bridge, but asks that they voluntarily remain in a viewing area set back away from the bridge. The Park Service has hired special rangers to explain the compromise to tourists.
This is my post. But before we go any further, welcome to Glen Canyon National Recreation Area and Rainbow Bridge. We claim to have the most beautiful office in the world.
And the only thing we try to educate our visitor is that they respect this place the same way as they would in their own place of worship. We do not throw trash on the church floor or in your church floor.
But Leo is realistic. He understands that Native Americans will face continued pressures as the West changes around them.
I think change is fast. Change is real. I think sometimes our people really don't have too much choice but to actually be adaptive. I know for a fact that it'll be a struggle for our people to maintain culture as well as religion, but I know it is possible.
If we lose the traditions of the Native Americans that so make the West unique, make us different from any other part of the nation, then we're going to lose the essence of the West.
As has always been the case, in the competition for the changing West, there will be winners and losers. While Leo Mannheimer has succeeded in raising awareness of Native American sacred sites, he knows the struggle will continue. And perhaps his greatest struggle is to keep his Navajo traditions alive in his children as they grow up in a changing West. While Diane and Arnie Holly have not lost the Overlook Ranch entirely, they have to accept that development is inevitable and that their own children will face even greater economic pressures if they decide to continue ranching. And for Lee and Billy Taylor, the future is bright for the moment. Yet they understand that more people just like them will continue to move to the West, further changing the place they've grown to love.
The only thing we can be absolutely certain about in the future is that the change is going to be even more striking, even more dynamic in the West. If the population projections made by experts are even half correct, the West we know today is going to be very, very different in 50 years. Because folks have come to the West and they do bring different ideas about ways to use the land, and their voices have to be heard. And indeed, their voices, that chorus is rising, and they're becoming much more influential. Part of what they have to embrace is a spirit of tolerance that has always existed in the West, so that they also take into consideration those who've been here before and make sure that there's a place for everybody in the new West of the next century.